Good morning. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to Top Quality Faith Ministries. My name is Darren. I'm going to be bringing the word to you today. But before we do get started, if you would like to be able to give to our ministry, there is a link below in our description that will take you directly to our giving page on our website, tqfm.org. If you would like to give via Zelle or PayPal, our username is finance@tqfm.org. Once again, that is finance@tqfm.org if you would like to be able to pour in or give unto this ministry. And so, without further ado, let's move forward and give the word of what God has for all of us today. So, learned behaviors. This is something that all of us deal with. At some point, somehow, some way, we deal with these learned behaviors. And it's something that most of us don't recognize unless Christ ends up showing us what it is that we're bringing into not just our daily lives as an adult or as we get older, but in our walk with Him. A lot of us tend to bring the things that we've learned in this world as we've grown up, because we've seen them, we've seen it practice, we've seen how it manifests, but we don't actually take into consideration what it is, or we don't take into consideration the relationship this way, how it can affect relationships this way. And well, and for most of us, it's like, okay, yeah, I know I'm supposed to, I follow Christ. I submit myself unto Him. I'm a living sacrifice unto You. And that is great, but what ends up happening for a lot of people is that they carry over history of what they've dealt with here on earth and what they've grown up in. What do I mean by that? It's like, for example, with me, I know that with basketball, I know when it's time for me to say something, step in, give assistance. If I walk into a gym and I'm seeing a group doing this and that, and a coach asks me about this, oh, just do this, just do that. This will be, have this guy do that. Oh, he's missing his shot like this. Have him get his elbow in, yada, yada, yada. I'm able to snap in just like that without any hesitation, because there's a confidence there. There's a confidence in my experience. There's a confidence there in my knowledge about the game. So when I'm talking basketball, I naturally just feel, oh, this is all it is. But like, for example, Christ wants me, he's telling me, hey, I want you to feed my sheep. Okay. So how do I do that? And so now I'm trying to pick from pastors, Pastor Kathy, Apostle Ken. Oh, this is how he does that. Oh, this is how she does that. But I'm trying to pick and look for an instruction as opposed to just going to do what Christ just asked me to do, which is feed his sheep. And you may say, well, if you don't know, you don't know. Yeah, but at the same time, when Christ gives us a direction and it's simple, that's all you can do. I remember Apostle Ken just talking, I believe it was last Sunday, just about if he just gives you a simple instruction, just go forth. Go forth. He didn't give you any other instruction. You can't try to figure out anything else to do. All you're supposed to do is just go. And for somebody like me, my learned behavior has affected how I'm able to receive from Christ. So my learned behaviors of this is what you do. When you do this, this will follow. Because that's what my life was, basketball. So it was around structure. It was around structure, but instruction too. So I actually had detailed instructions of how to follow, plays to follow, fundamentals to follow. And now I'm having to go through the fundamentals of understanding what grace looks like. The fundamentals of understanding what a father's love looks like. The fundamentals of understanding what it is I can move forward in to really be useful by Christ. And it's a part of me learning my personal identity in the body of Christ, because I can't look to another person. I can't try to ask somebody what I'm supposed to do when Christ is the one that told me I'm supposed to do it. They know from their bearing witness with Christ that I'm supposed to be doing something, but they can't tell me what to do because they're not me, just like I'm not them. And I have to understand that as I'm continuing to grow and walk forward in Christ, there's going to have to be some literal jump out on faith leaps. And that's scary. And for anybody that has dealt with fear, you naturally tend to, I guess you can say, regress back to your safe and comfort zone. So if I don't know how to do something, my tendency was growing up was I'm going to be quiet. I'm going to sit back because I'd rather not look like a fool or look like I don't know what I'm doing. So I don't have that embarrassment feeling of what I look like to others. And it's like, oh, okay. And so I'm like, Lord, so you're trying to help when you're telling me I need to go forward in you, when I need to step out, when I need to feed your sheep. It literally just means talk to them about me. Talk to them about my love for you. Talk to them about how it is that you're seeing how the natural things of what you would do as a kid, how they've come up in your marriage. How it's so hard for you to understand communication of engaging with somebody because you just didn't do it as a kid. My communication was, let me do something to get you to see me. I wasn't even worried about the conversation. I was worried about if you actually even seen me, just the person. Because if you at least seen me, that's all the validation I need. But why? Simply because of a true father's love. And most of you have heard my testimony about how the Lord literally brought me out of depression once basketball was done for with me, because I didn't feel like it was nothing else. Basketball was my life. And God's love for me personally was so strong that it wouldn't even let me fail. And so when he's bringing up learned behaviors to me, when he's bringing up things of what, you know, you've learned to cope with, it sticks out to me, because it is something that a lot of us, I don't think we really pay attention to. And like, we're going to go into the word, looking at Samson, and how he pointed him out to me was basically Samson was hurt. Samson, and it's a small story, it's a small sample of what we get in the word to be able to see Samson's story. But Samson was hurt on a level that most people today can honestly relate to, because Samson didn't deal with his hurt. He didn't deal with the pain that he was actually feeling. I didn't deal with my issues of my identity growing up. I didn't talk to somebody about how I was truly feeling. But I just brushed it aside. Just ignore it. That's the enemy trying to distract you. Don't be consumed in that. You're stronger than that. Just push beyond it. You don't need people's validation. Don't even think about it. But I want to be felt like I'm valued, though. You are valued. Okay, I hear you saying that. You're a family member. But why is this person and this person that is supposed to be close to me, or this family member that's close to me, why don't they look at me the same way? Why is it that you say you love me and I'm your blood, but I'm touched this way? How is it that you touch me this way, but when I go to such and such's house, they touch me in a different way? Like, where does that happen? But see, those kind of conversations, they're either thrown out, or they're pushed aside, or they're buried, because they're uncomfortable. And nobody wants to deal with that. Nobody wants to feel that hurt. Nobody wants to feel that pain. Nobody wants to actually talk about those issues. And that's just what happened with Samson. And we're just going to, we're kind of brushing through his story. And because we'll start in Judges 14. And he's born. And of course, he's grown up at this time. But let's read through this story. And I mean, it's clear as day as to, I mean, you literally feel, you would think this could honestly be on some kind of sitcom or some kind of drama show today. Because it's this plot actually has been played out in quite a few drama movies as of late. But here we go. Judges 14, 1 through 4, and then jumping down through 15 through 20. Samson went down to Timnah, and at Timnah he saw a woman, one of the daughters of the Philistines. So he went back and told his father and his mother, "I saw a woman in Timnah, one of the daughters of the Philistines. Now get her for me as a wife." But his father and mother said to him, "Is there no woman among the daughters of your relatives or among all our people that you must go take a wife from the uncircumcised pagan Philistines?" And I'm reading the Amplified Version too for you guys. "And Samson said to his father, 'Get her for me because she looks pleasing to me.' His father and mother did not know that it was of the Lord and that he was seeking an occasion to take action against the Philistines. Now at that time, the Philistines were ruling over Israel." This first little piece, you get to see clearly. It doesn't matter. I just like what I see. I just want this kind of place. I just want this kind of job. I just want to have this kind of financial status. I just want to be able to have this kind of title. I just want to have this kind of wife. I just want to have this kind of husband. You're looking, but you're not using discernment. Look at how Samson was brought up, though, too. He was set aside by God. Now, understand, there's a level of, responsibility that goes with what he was supposed to be doing. And to whom much is given, much is required. Yes. But as a child growing up, if you see yourself not doing the things as other kids, what's the initial thing that you would want to do? Why am I being singled out? And it the word, at least, doesn't give us enough detail to show that Samson's father was a man that truly believed. Because even the angel came to the woman first. He came to the mother first. She had to go tell the husband. That right there should have been enough. But he didn't believe. So if he's at a place of disbelief of what truly is of God, that he has to see things, that's something that's going to be passed on. See, there's something there with Samson's father and his relationship. Samson should be able to go to his father, "Dad, why is it that I'm being separated from these kids?" "Because you're too good." Like pouring positivity into his son, as opposed to just telling him, "You're supposed to be separated because you're unto God." See, it's a difference of being told something to do that's right, and being and having love poured into you with understanding. And how the best way I can say it is, like, for example, a person can do something wrong at a job. They get it wrong. But there's managers and bosses that will literally point out all of the mistakes that the person has made. "You did this wrong. You did this wrong. You shouldn't have done this. Why would you do this? All of them are true statements, but where's the teachable moment in it? But that person can't teach you something that they don't have. But see, have a person come that tells you, I understand what you did. I understand why. How can we better this in the future? What's going to be the next steps? What can I do to help you? Two bosses, same situation, but it's going to get a different result. Because one understands, okay, yeah, you did mess up. I know you already feel bad. If you don't feel bad and you did something wrong, okay, that's a whole nother subject for another day. But if you are in a place of, like I would say, most people are, it's like, okay, I know I messed up. Oops, I'm sorry. Not gonna happen again. There's something there that can be built upon. And see, with Samson, that's what I said. The word doesn't give us enough detail, but there's been times in this in the word that it gives us detail. Like, for example, I think of Joseph. You got a chance to really see how Joseph was loved on by his father. He got the jacket because he was truly loved by his father. It was evident to Joseph that his father really loved him and was pouring more into him than than the other sons. And we can get into that more later, but the word just doesn't leave out certain details if they're necessary. And the focal point here is truly Samson. But you don't get a chance to really see him and his father's engagement except, oh, he helped him do this, helped him do that. Like, let's go further into that scripture, jumping down to the 15th verse. Says, then on the fourth day, they said to Samson's wife, persuade your husband to tell us through you the answer to his riddle, or we will burn you and your father's household with fire. Have you invited us to make us poor? Is this not true? So Samson's wife wept before him and said, you only hate me. You do not love me. You have asked my countrymen a riddle and have not told the answer to me. The guilt trip. I mean, Pop's couldn't tell him that. Pop, his dad been married for how long? The wife gonna try to pull something on you, young fella. I'ma tell you. He couldn't do something like just give him a forewarning or something about that. But hey, I don't know. Maybe they did have to talk and he ignored it. I don't know. We don't know. We can only go by what we read. But she continues on, and he said to her, listen, I have not told my father or my mother either, so why should I tell you? However, Samson's wife wept before him 7 days while their wedding feast lasted. And on the seventh day, he told her because she pressed him so hard. Then she told the answer to the riddle to her countrymen. I guess I'm stopping right here and pausing because just right there, you get a chance to see. A person that loves you will validate your feelings. I'll say that again. person that loves you is going to validate your feelings. And what do I mean by that? They're going to respect how you feel. I can disagree with your opinion about something, a statement, whatever. But I can respect how you feel and acknowledge that what you feel means something because it's you. It's your feeling. That's something of a relationship. That's something I'm even still continuing to learn as a husband. That's why communication is so vital, as I'm continuing to learn. Because right here, clearly, he's not trying to tell the riddle. It's something that's like, oh, but you know, they're one, right? They are. But the pressing, it's the pressing of her will onto him that is not only about to cause a disaster for those involved immediately, but others. So not only does this issue, and not only does that issue that, you know, with that person, not just affect you and that person's relationship, but it can bleed into other things. And other people can suffer because of it. Because once that happens, it turns into a traumatic event. It turns into a learned behavior. See, you get somebody learning to suppress what they feel long enough, pretty soon, eventually, when it's time for them to speak up, you got something to say? No, I'm okay. You sure? I'm sure. You're fine. You're fine. And they just, it's fine. It's fine. It's fine. Don't worry about it. But it's not fine. But you've gotten so used to suppressing, and somebody has pressed their way onto you and their version of what you should feel like, that now you can't even stand up in what God is asking you to try to do. You may have an idea about something and a great idea, and it needs to move forward. But because your feelings hasn't been validated and you're used to that as the norm for you, now when it's time for a crisis, say, I want you to speak up. That's okay. Somebody else will be able to figure that out. No, I want you to figure it out. But Lord, I don't know how to say this. And we start coming up with those excuses of why I can't do this, why I can't do that. And it's like, I guess I can say something. Maybe I should. Yes, I got to have the power. I got to just be strong like Christ, right? I got to have the mind. He's with me. He's with me. And now you're trying to fight to believe that Christ is giving you something. You have to fight to feel like you're a part of. And it's like, it's not supposed to be that hard. That's why Christ came, to make it easy for us. That all we have to do is say, Lord, here am I. That, Lord, thank you for your love upon the cross, that you died to give me this power and authority that I can be able to speak to these things and move this way. But we can't. because something traumatic or somebody has pressed on their will on you, and it's become a learned behavior. Keep watching how what happens here. As she talks on, as the scripture comes to the end of it. So then, reading again from verse 16. So Samson's wife wept before him and said, "You only hate me, you do not love me. You have asked my countrymen a riddle and have not told the answer to me." He said to her, "Listen, I have not told my father or my mother either, so why should I tell you?" Samson's wife wept before him 7 days while their wedding feast lasted. And on the seventh day, he told her because she pressed him so hard. Then she told the answer to the riddle to her countrymen. So the men of the city said to Samson on the seventh day before sundown, "What is sweeter than honey? What is stronger than a lion?" And he said to them, "If you had not plowed with my heifer," and he called her a heifer. That just showed you how bad mad he was. Ouch. "You would not have solved my riddle." Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon him mightily, and he went down to Ashkelon and killed 30 of them and took their gear and gave changes of clothes to those who had explained the riddle. And his anger burned, and he went up to his father's house. He went back to go talk to his dad. He had just been crushed. It's one of those situations. Think of it this way. Your parents telling you, "Yo, don't mess with that girl. I'm telling you, I'm seeing it coming. Don't do it." And you gonna go and get with her, having fun. It's looking like it's gonna be great. Sure enough, she breaks your heart. You go back to the parents. Watch this last bit, the last scripture though. After Samson went back to his father's house, he went up to his father's house, but Samson's wife was given to his companion who had been his friend. So you go back to your father's house for comfort, because you've been embarrassed. You've been embarrassed. And seeing this is at a time where there's nothing about grace. There is literally just no, there's no, "Oh, it's okay. You're going to be okay." No, you made this decision. You're going to have to deal with it yourself. So him trying to come back to a father that's going to be compassionate or something like that, that's not going to happen right now. Because, see, this is during the law time. This is when the law is straight there. Either you do this or you cut off. Plain and simple. But you get hurt by the love of your life that he thinks is the love of his life. But you end up being alone, and she leaves with your best friend. Yeah, that's going to be causing quite a bit of hurt. And it's like this situation, this happens to so many people on so many different levels. It's not even just with a marriage. It's just with friends. It's with family members. You may have somebody that has done you so wrong that was supposed to be there for you, but because the person was supposed to love you in such a way unconditionally, and that hurt came from them, it takes on a different kind of sting. See, it's one thing for, okay, you know, a friend, an associate, I say an associate, a person that you know at a place at work or at school or something, it's something for you to know that, okay, they screwed me, whatever. They wasn't really down with me like that. That kind of stuff, yes, it hurts, but at the end of the day, moves on. But when that hurt comes from somebody that is supposed to protect you and love you, like a parent, a sibling, somebody that, despite anything, they're supposed to be there for you. But when that hurt comes from them, that's a different kind of trauma. That takes a different kind of play. That hits a different kind of nerve. Because now, look at this. They're supposed to love you, protect you. Now when you try to come to Christ and understand how he, when he says, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you, your belief is conflicted because of this trauma. You can try to push through, you can pray, you can fast, you can do all of these things. And I'm speaking about this from my own personal experience. Because I've tried to pray through. I've tried to, you know, fast through and try to seek God so much more and so much more. And he's like, you just need to talk to somebody. You need to talk with another person about your hurt, about what it is that you've been through. You ain't even got to talk to the person that did it to you. Because you don't even know who the source is truly coming from. I'm going to show you down the line, but it's not even anything that serious. And so I'm like, Lord, why are you showing me this with Samson? And he's like, you're going to see. This man was hurt and didn't know how to deal with it. And so, let's continue on to the next chapter. Judges 15:1. But after a while, in the time of wheat harvest, Samson went to visit his wife with a young goat as a gift of reconciliation. Look at this. He's going. He's trying to make, you know what? I'm sorry. I know I overreacted. Baby, just come back to me. Coming back like boys to men on bended knee. Come on, girl. And he said, I will go into my wife in her room. He's like, yeah, we going to be good. But her father would not allow him to go in. Say what? Hold on. That's my wife. Why can't I? You know. I'm trying to make things right. She belongs to me. Covenant. That's what we do. Covenant means a covenant. But you see who we made the covenant with? And what is the Philistines always represented in the word? You can't try to make a covenant with the world. because it's contracting. That's why you see people being able to get hop in and out of marriages just like that, because it's not a covenant. It's a contract. If you do this, 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 we cool. We can stay together. But let you act up one time. Let you lose your temper one time. Deuce. That's just what happened here. He comes from a lineage that understands what a covenant is. Philistines don't understand that. Covenant. You see what you just did? How crazy you was? How angry you were? Why wouldn't you have done that to me? And I'm not even putting myself in that position. No way, no way. Bye-bye. And look at this. Reading again from verse 2. Her father said, I really thought you utterly hated her, so I gave her to your companion. Is her younger sister not more beautiful than she? Please take her as your wife instead. Samson said to them, this time I shall be blameless in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm. So Samson went and caught 300 foxes and took torches too, and turning the fox's tail to tail, he put a torch between each pair of tails. When he had set the torch ablaze, he let the foxes go into the standing grain of the Philistines, and he burned up the heap of sheaves and the standing grain, along with the vineyards and olive groves. Then the Philistines said, who did this? And they were told, Samson, the son-in-law of the Timnite, because he took Samson's wife and gave her to his chief companion at the wedding feast. So the Philistines came up and burned her and her father with fire. So they ended up suffering because Samson was pretty ticked off, hurt. And that hurt led to rage. That rage caused others to get caught in the crossfire. That happens, sadly, too often, because people just want to act on it, just that immediate feeling. You don't want to talk about why you're hurt. Couldn't Samson have talked to him? Tried to reason with him? He can't do something that he doesn't have. What is it that you don't have that's keeping you from moving in the direction that God is trying to push you in? Is it a lack of love? Is it a lack of compassion? Is it a lack of assertiveness? Because this is speaking all through me. Because I know I'm supposed to do things, but I'm just sitting here in my comfort zone of learned behavior. If I don't know how to do it, I'll just wait for the Lord to do something for me. No. You got to start talking about why you feel like that. I have to actually start talking about why I feel like I'm reluctant to lead. Because the truth of the matter is, I don't want to mess up. But how can I mess up if I'm in Christ? I can't mess up in Christ Because if I'm in Christ, he makes no mistakes. So if I'm resting in him, his righteousness, his perfection, his wholeness, his love, his peace, and I'm just going along, what can I be doing wrong? Learning from your mistakes. That's something that I tried to do. And the more that I kept reading through this, as you were gonna see, Samson didn't. He didn't. He literally had an exact situation happen to him the exact same way. And so let's go to Judges 16:1. It says, then Samson went to Gaza. Now, remember and understand, this is literally right after he pretty much kills 1,000 men with the jawbone of the donkey. Because he is so filled with so much rage, such anger about what has been done to him. Look what the first thing is that he does as soon as he gets some, I guess you can say, free time. Then Samson went to Gaza and saw a prostitute there and went in to her. He went into a prostitute. He went into somebody to have a quick sense of satisfaction because he was so hurt. How many times do we run into situations that we know it's going to be wrong? But you still do it anyway. This is a learned behavior. He doesn't know what else to do. He goes back to his family. It's going to be embarrassment because all they're going to do is point out his faults. Who else can he go to? God. But why should I go to God? Because I haven't done what he's wanted me to do. So I feel even more embarrassed of coming to him because I know what I'm called to do, but I don't even want to go to him because he's God. And like I said, this is still in that Old Testament time. So it's like, I'm supposed to be set aside and I'm doing this. Not so good. Goes into a prostitute. Jump down to verse 4. After this, he fell in love with a Philistine woman living in the valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah. So the five lords governors of the Philistines came to her and said to her, persuade him and see where his great strength lies and find out how we may overpower him so that we may bind him and subdue him. And each of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver. Then she said to him, how can you say, jumping down, I'm sorry, to verse 15, because just for time. Then she said to him, how can you say I love you when your heart is not with me? Have you mocked me these three times and have not told me where your great strength lies? When she pressured him day after day with her words and pleaded with him, he was annoyed to death. Just saying. He was annoyed. Didn't something like this happen to him before? of a lady crying, saying, "Why don't you love me like this? Don't you love me like this? If you love me, why won't you?" That's not love. That's called manipulation. That's called persuasion. That's called control. Because why else press so hard? People go after what it is that they want. So my feelings about us not going to be somewhere alone while we're not married, that's not respected because, you see, it's like, because that's what I'm saying. And please understand, these thoughts cross our minds. They've crossed my mind. I've been in those positions. I've been the one to say, well, I mean, we are together. So, you know, that counts as it, as, you know, us being married. Like, there's a conscious effort to follow through. But if it's not respected, what is that truly saying about your respect for the other person? This is stuff I have to look at myself. This is what I have to look at. It's not something about of you're doing this wrong or you're doing that right and you're doing this wrong. No, because I'm seeing myself all through this. You get, God gets you out of a situation, gives you a chance, and you crawl right back into another bad situation. These learned behaviors, they're your safety net. It's what you feel comfortable with. That's why you come up with the justification for keeping that person around. That's why you come up with the justification for sleeping with that person. That's why you come up with the justification for having that drink or having that hit or doing whatever it is or watching that pornography film. It anything of that matter, it doesn't matter. Because it's a learned behavior that has not been dealt with. And so, I mean, you guys know the story with him. Pretty much, Delilah finds out what his secret is, cuts, shaves off his head, everything, gone. Wakes up, recognizes that the Spirit of God is not with him anymore. Uh-oh. Gouges out his eyes. So now he can't even see. Made fun of, brought out in front of thousands of the Philistines as they're partying. Hey, bring him on out here so we can make fun of him. Make a mockery of him. Making a mockery of Christ. Because this was the man of God. And look what we was able to do. Now, see, it's not too late. It's never too late. Christ is always trying to do something through you because his love for you is that strong. It doesn't matter how deep and how dark it gets for you. he's always there. Because see, just with Samson, even though he was blind, and the word says, his hair started to grow back. And what happened is, as that hair is growing back, God is starting to give him revelation of where he fell short. So now, there comes a moment. Hair is growing back. Christ is starting to visit him in this dark place because he can't see nothing. He can't see any way to go. I believe what was the last part of that chapter? I think, let's go down to this, Judges 16 and 28. Then Samson called to the Lord and said, O Lord God, please remember me and please strengthen me just this one time. O God, and let me take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes. Samson took hold of the two middle support pillars on which the house rested and braced himself against them, one with the right hand and the other with his left. And Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And he stretched out with all his might, collapsing the support pillars. And the house fell on the Lord and of all the people who were in it. So the dead whom he killed at his death were more than those whom he had killed during his entire life. It was something about this that struck me of how Samson was hurt. He was hurt. And some of us have really been hurt. And we've not dealt with it. You may think that because you don't think about it, that it's not there. You may think that because I've forgiven that person, I moved on, it's whatever. But how you know is if that person's name comes up or if something with that person strikes something up in you, like some type of a feeling. That's something in a negative, whether it's judgment, something. That's how you know there's still something there that Christ needs to heal. And sometimes you need to just go to a therapist. There's nothing wrong with that. It's been so looked down upon, at least I know, with my culture and growing up, that mental health is a spirit, and it just needs to be prayed out, and it's whatever. And it's like, I understand there's spiritual warfare out there, and it's very real and it's very true. But sometimes you just need to talk to somebody. Because, see, you can pray all you want for forgiveness this way from God. That's what Christ died on the cross for, forgiveness of sins. But healing, let's actually just read the actual word for what healing, how healing comes. James 5 and 16. Therefore, confess your sins to one another, your false steps, your offenses, and pray for one another that you may be healed. and restored. The heartfelt and persistent prayer of a righteous man is able to accomplish much when put into action and made effective by God. It is dynamic and can have tremendous power. Your forgiveness comes through Christ, through the Father, forgiveness of your sins, but your healing through that pain comes through talking with your brother and sister. There's something powerful when we communicate with one another. There's something powerful when we're able to rest in knowing that I have somebody I can talk to. I can pick up the phone and call. Because I can call somebody that will hold me accountable if I'm having a sudden urge or wanting to have a drink or whatever it may be. I don't know what it may be for you. But know that there is nothing more powerful than love. Nothing. And I'm speaking from my own experience because that dark place that I was in, it was nothing but God's love for me that pulled me out. He loves you. He sent his son to die just for you. There's absolutely nothing that you can't do without him. Nothing. I don't know who is listening, but God wants you to know he's seen everything. He knows how you were raised. He knows what you are subject to. You may not have told nobody, but he's seen it. He's seen the tears about it. He's seen your nightmares about it. But he has you. And you may say, how does he have me when I'm still dealing with what I'm dealing with? It's in that answer right there. You're dealing with it because he's still taking you through. He's guiding you like you would be gone or in a worse place, but by his grace, the circumstance hasn't overtaken you. By his love for you, it hasn't overpowered you. See, a lot of us look at the hurt and the pain and the memories as a point of not being healed. And I think of the scripture now that comes to mind of when Paul has the thorn in his side. It is a reminder constantly that he just cannot ignore. And he tried to pray it away. And this is Paul we're talking about. But it was there. It could have been seen as a bad hindrance or something keeping him back from moving forward in his ministry. But it was used as a tool to remind him, no matter what, it's never going to be able to break you. It's never going to be able to take you back, because my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. So you may see your shortcomings as something that it's like it's keeping you back. No, it's not. Because you haven't been broken. It hasn't taken you out. You're still standing. You're still here by the love of God. He loves you. 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 And I'm wrapping this up. I know this has been a lot, but there's still even so much more for me to even digest with this. Because we don't look, and I think of the scripture also, of train up a child in the way that they should go, and they will not depart from it. That has played its way on the other stuff too. Things that you don't think your child is seeing, they're seeing. They're studying. Little bad habits, little white lies, how you engage with men, women, they see it. May not understand it, but they see it. Learned behaviors. And so now, once it's time for you to actually have a full-on relationship with Christ, you got to understand, he got to peel back some layers. And it was so beautiful how the Lord had shown me this. Because immediately, when I think of, oh my gosh, like, why have I been doing this? I need to get this better. I need to do this. The Lord had put it as simple as this to me. Conviction equals revelation. Condemnation equals self-righteousness. I'll say that again. Conviction equals revelation. Condemnation equals self-righteousness. And the reason he had pointed that out to me, because immediately as a believer and feeling like I should be somewhere in Christ, not doing this, not doing that, or not falling to this level or falling to that, that's condemnation, because condemnation comes with I shouldn't, comes back to my works. I shouldn't be doing this. It's pointing to you. Conviction, though, when it comes to conviction, that's a revelation, because it's like, oh, snap. I didn't even realize I was, oh, man, that's, yeah. I see where I did that wrong. I am so sorry. There's revelation there of understanding. There's growth there. So with the conviction, it's not going to just stay there and you trying to figure it out. It's actually coming with a revelation to actually help you grow and move forward and now be able to have freedom in an area where you didn't have it before. But I know I've taken up a lot of your time today. I'm going to close out with this scripture. The Lord is having this scripture come back to my mind. Most of you know it. 2 Corinthians 3 and 18. And we all with unveiled face, continually seeing as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are progressively being transformed into his image from one degree of glory to even more glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. This is a progression. You're constantly going to be transformed, but you have to look to Christ. You have to look to the Word because it's going to show you yourself. It's going to show you where you're at. And continue to rest in his love for you. If there is any of you that may have not accepted Christ as your personal Savior today, and you're hearing this message, and you stumble across it, we want to offer you this time, at this time, a chance to become a believer. And it is very simple. If you're watching or listening, just repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I have sinned. I've recognized that I am a sinner, but I also recognize that your Son came to die for my sins. And because of that, I am forgiven of all my past, my present, and my future sins. Thank you, Lord, for loving me enough that I can be brought into your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you've prayed that prayer, welcome to the family. If you are have any questions, or if you are want to speak to someone, we will not be having our prayer after service today, as most of our prayer team, I believe, is still traveling back and on the road. But please, if you do have any questions or any type of inquiries or prayer requests, please send them to info@tqfm.org, and we will try to reach out to you and get back to you as soon as we possibly can. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you for joining me. I love you. God loves you. Have a blessed week, blessed day, and God be with you. Love you.